ಸನ್ನಾಮರೂಪಾಭ್ಯಾಮೇವ ವ್ಯಾಕ್ರಿಯತೆ ಅಸೌ ನಾಮಾನಿದಂ ರೂಪ ಇತಿ ತದಿದಮಪ್ಯೇತರ್ಹಿ ನಾಮರೂಪಾಭ್ಯಾಮೇವ ವ್ಯಾಕ್ರಿಯತೆ ಅಸೌ ನಾಮಾನಿದಂ ರೂಪ ಇತಿ ಪ್ರವಿಷ್ಟಾನಖಾಗ್ರೇಭ್ಯಕ್ಷುರಹಕ್ಷುರಧಾನೇ ವಹಿತ ವಿಶ್ವಂಭರೋ ವಾ ವಿಶ್ವಂಭರ್ಕುಲಾಯೇ ತನ್ನ ಪಶ್ಯಂತಿ ನ ಕೃತ್ಸ್ನೋ ಹಿ ಸಹ ಪ್ರಾಣನ್ನೇವ ಪ್ರಾಣೋ ನಾಮ ಭವತಿ ವದನ್ವಾ ಪಶ್ಯಂಶ್ಚಕ್ಷುಃ ಶೃಣ್ವನ್ ಶ್ರೋತ್ರಂ ಮನ್ವಾನೋ ಮನಃ ತಾನ್ಯಸ್ಯೈಕಾನಿ ಕರ್ಮನಾಮಾನ್ಯೇವ ಸಯೋತ ಏಕೈಕಮುಪಾಸ್ತೇನ ಸ ವೇದ ಕೃತ್ಸ್ನೋ ಹ್ಯೇಷಃ ಅತ ಏಕೈಕೇನ ಭವತಿ ಆತ್ಮೇತ್ಯೇವೋಪಾಸೀತ ಅತ್ರ ಹ್ಯೇತೆ ಸರ್ವ ಏಕಂ ಭವಂತಿ ತದೈತತ್ ಪದನೀಯಮಸ್ಯ ಸರ್ವಸ್ಯೇದಯಂ ಆತ್ಮ ಅನೇನ ಹ್ಯೇತಂ ಸರ್ವಂ ವೇಹೇತತ್ ಸರ್ವಂ ವೇದ ಯಥಾಹ ವೈ ಪದೇನಾನುವಿಂದೇ ದೇವಂ ಶ್ಲೋಕಂ ವಿಂದತೇಯ ಏವಂ ವೇದ ಉಪಾಸನೇನ ಆತ್ಮವಿಷಯಂ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟಂ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಾಂತರಂ ಭಾವಯೇತ್. ಉಪಾಸನೇನ ಆತ್ಮೇತ್ಯ ಉಪಾಸಿತ. ಒನ್ ಶುಡ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಟ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಆತ್ಮ ಇಂಡಿ ಉಪಾಸಿತ. ಸೊ ಬೈ ದ ವರ್ಡ್ ಉಪಾಸಿತ, ಸೊ ಉಪಾಸನೇನ ಆತ್ಮವಿಷಯ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟಂ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಾಂತರಂ ಭಾವೇ. ಸೊ ಬೈ ಉಪಾಸನ ಇಸ್ ಮೈನ್ ವಿಶಿಷ್ಟಂ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಾಂತರಂ, ಅ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ಆತ್ಮವಿಷಯ ಪರ್ಟೈನಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಆತ್ಮ ಭಾವೇ. So one should in fact meditate upon the Atma in order to get some vishishtam, some special kind of a knowledge. Tena Atma Jnayate. It is this kind of a special knowledge that takes place because of meditation upon the Atma that the Atma is known. Avidya Nivartakam Chatadeva. And it is that special knowledge which dispels the ignorance pertaining to Atma. ಆತ್ಮವಿಷಯಂ ವೇದವಾಕ್ಯ ಜನಿತಂ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಂ ಇತಿ. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ದ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ಸೊ ವೆನ್ ಯು ಲಿಸನ್ ಟು ದಿ ಆತ್ಮ, ಲಿಸನ್ ಟು ದ ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ದಟ್ ಟೇಕ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ದಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಡಿಸ್ಪೆಲ್ ದ ಇಗ್ನರೆನ್ಸ್. ಬಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಗೈನ್ ದಟ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್, ದನ್ ಒನ್ ಶುಡ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಟ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ದಿ ಆತ್ಮ, ವಿಚ್ ಜನರೇಟ್ಸ್ ಅನದರ್ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ವಿಚ್ ದೇ ವುಡ್ ಕಾಲ್ ಅಪರೋಕ್ಷ ಜ್ಞಾನಂ ಆರ್ ಆತ್ಮ ಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ಕಾರ. ಸೊ ಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ಕಾರ ಟೇಕ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್, ಅಪರೋಕ್ಷ ಜ್ಞಾನ ಇಸ್ ಜನರೇಟೆಡ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ಮೆಡಿಟೇಷನ್, ಫಾರ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆಫನ್ ದ ಯೂಸ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ನಿಧಿಧ್ಯಾಸನ. ಸೊ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಡು ನಿಧಿಧ್ಯಾಸನ ಅಂಡ್ ದಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ಟೇಕ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಬೈ ವಿಚ್ ದ ಜನರಲ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಗೇನ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ದ ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ದೆನ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ಕಾರ, ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಅಪರೋಕ್ಷಂ, ಬಿಕಮ್ಸ್ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ ನಾಲೆಜ್. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಸಮ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಸೇ. ನ ಆತ್ಮ ನ ಏತಸ್ಮಿನ್ ಅರ್ಥೇ ವಚನಾನಿ ಅಪಿ. And in order to support this view, they quote these statements from the Upanishads. Vijnaya prajnam kurvita. Vijnaya, having once understood the Atma from the scriptures, prajnam kurvita, one should then generate that prajna or that special kind of a knowledge for which one should perform the meditation. Drashtavya, shrotavya, mantavya, nididhyasitavya. That Atma must be known, seen. Shrutavya, first it should be listened to. Mantavya, it should be then deliberated upon. nididhyasatavyah. So by shravanam and mananam, so by listening and by the reflection, the knowledge that you gain, then you should meditate upon the Atma, nididhyasatavyah, to generate a special kind of a knowledge by which the Atma is known. And it is that special knowledge which dispels the ignorance, and not just the knowledge that you gain from listening and reflection upon the scriptures. This is the contention of the Purvapaksha. And in short, after gaining the knowledge of the scriptures by Shravanam and Manan also, something remains to be done. That's the idea. Having now listened to the scriptures, you must go to the Himalayas and do the sadhana, and then you must meditate upon the Atma, and then only the Sakshatkara will take place. So point is that after Shravanam and Mananam also, Kartavyantaram, something remains to be done. This is the contention. The Shravanam or listening to the scriptures cannot generate Aparoksha Jnanam, cannot generate Atma Sakshatkara. Because Shabda or the words are only capable of generating Paroksha Jnanam, they can only generate the indirect knowledge. And in order to transform that knowledge from Paroksha to Aparoksha, from mediate to immediate knowledge, some Kartavyantaram, something still remains to be done, which is what is called meditation or upasana. And it is that upasana, that special meditation that you should perform in order for the Atma Sakshatkara to take place. And it is that knowledge, that manasa kriya, that kind of meditation which is what is enjoined by the Upanishad, when the Upanishad says Atmetya Upasita. So contention here is, what Vaishyakara is going to reply, what he's replying is, that we are not at the moment dwelling upon some special kind of a knowledge, etc. All we are saying here is there a Kartavyantaram? Is there some other Kartavya? Meaning that having understood the Atma from the scriptures, does anything remain to be done? We say that nothing remains to be done having understood the Atma. So Atma is to be understood. Atma is not to be produced. If Atma were not there, and had it to be produced, then some kind of an action would have been required. Because if Atma were Utpadya, if Atma was not present and had to be made manifest, like submarine, you know, so Atma is embedded in the thoughts, and then you must bring it to the surface. If something had to be done to the Atma, then definitely some kind of an action would have been required. But all there is Atma. If there was something other than Atma, then it's all right. Whatever there is Atma alone. So where can Atma hide and where can it disappear? It can only hide behind the Brahma. It can only hide behind the notion. It cannot hide behind anything else. What is lying in front of me is rope. It is not hiding from me. But that I take it to be snake. So that Brahma or that delusion of a snake, that this is a snake, it is that conclusion or a complex that this is a snake, that is what conceals the rope from me and nothing else. So it is ignorance that conceals the rope from me and nothing else. Ignorance that brings about a notion that this is a snake. And so also, what conceals the Atma from me? Atma or the Self is self-effulgent, ever shining. And that alone shines, there is nothing else to shine. Maya tadamidam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina. I alone shine as in whole creation. So that I is to be recognized. Is to be recognized or understood rather than created. So if Atma were to be created, some action would be required. But to know something that is already there in front of you, or to know something that you already know, to know something that you already know, what action can be required other than to say that what you already know is probably not right and therefore it has to be rightly known. So we know the Atma even today also. Everyone knows Atma because we cannot but know the Atma. Atma being self-effulgent, self-shining, you cannot but know it because you have no choice in not knowing the Self, because any process of knowledge can take place only when the I is first established. So unless the eye shines, nothing else shines. Jānāmi tameva bhāntam anubhāt yetat samastam jagat. Only when it shines, Jānāmi. I know, or I, only when the Atma shines in that manner, then alone the whole world can shine, meaning that any knowledge or experience requires Atma to be there in the first place. And therefore, every experience in fact involves experience of Atma, or every knowledge involves knowledge of Atma. So it is not that Atma is not known. It is not also that the Upanishads make us know an Atma and an unknown Atma. So that will be discussed in the second part, you know, when Bhashyakara will answer. So what is being answered now is something as Arthantara Bhavat. No kartavya remains once you gain that scriptures are competent to give you knowledge. That buddhi, our intellect, has the ability to know Atma, number one. And that the words of scriptures, when properly unfolded, can make the intellect know. And that being the case, nothing remains to be done when once you know the Atma, to know the Atma. You might say that something remains to be done in order to become free from what we call the habitual error. So what is the role of Nididhyasanam? Role of Nididhyasana is to release me from habitual error, not to make me know. So here the position is that knowledge can only take place in Shravanam. Shravanam meaning listening or deliberating upon the scriptures. And so we may say that even that process of Shravanam can be extended even from a classroom situation, which is of course Shravanam. It is possible that you are dwelling upon what you listened to in the class, and therefore what I have understood can click later. That can happen. We would call it Shravanam alone, because merely independent thinking cannot generate new knowledge, because all thinking or meditation is always going to be confined to my present boundaries of knowledge. I can never dwell upon something that I do not already know. Or I can only meditate upon something that I know, or in the manner in which I know a given thing, I can meditate upon that. But all new knowledge can only take place when I am made to know that. And in particular about the self, that when I am made to see the nature of the self, then alone the knowledge can take place. And therefore, it is only by Shravanam, meaning only by unfoldment of the scriptures, only by the deliberation upon the scriptures, that the knowledge of Atma can take place. So now Vaishyakara is answering. What is the answer that is given here is to the first question, which was that knowledge is something to be enjoined. That jnanam, that Atma itya upasita. That knowledge, that is here a vidhi or an injunction pertaining to knowledge. Even that much is not, even that injunction, knowledge cannot become the object of any kind of an instruction. Knowledge cannot involve any kind of an action. Knowledge takes place, and therefore, as long as some action is there, so long knowledge doesn't take place. In short, just as I perceive this object, the knowledge takes place. And therefore, no action is involved, because jnanam is vastu tantram. Knowledge is something that is determined by the object of knowledge. And therefore, the knower does not have any sankalpa. I cannot have sankalpa or a free will to decide that I am going to know this object as a pot or as an elephant. I have to know it as a flower as it is, or as whatever object. But Swami, suppose I do not know that this is jasmine flower, then what? We are not talking of that. When is the knowledge? Means perception. So I perceive an object as it is. When the eyes are open, the object is perceived as it is. So also the mind's eyes are open, then Atma is perceived as it is. This is the idea. So said Vashyakara on the page 222, Na Arthantara Abhavat. Says Vashyakara that Kartavyantara Abhavat. Once the knowledge of the self has taken place, there is no kartavya, nothing remains to be done to create knowledge. Something may remain to be done to remove the habitual error, but nothing remains to be done in order to create the knowledge. Na means what? Na cha atmetyopasita iti apuro vidhi. Atmetyopasita. When the Upanishad says, one should meditate upon the Atma, we are just translating as meditate because Upasita. One should meditate upon the Atma. This is not an injunction on meditation. So they say that Atma is to be meditated upon. We say that no, there is Upasita is not an injunction pertaining to meditation or knowledge of Brahma. They say that Veda and Upasana both mean the same. And so, Tanna Pashyanti or Nasa Veda, he does not know. Then Atmetyo Upasita, then one should meditate upon the Atma. Anena Kheta Sarvam Veda. So that, by that alone, if one knows everything. So they said that Veda and Upasanam, knowledge and Upasana are one alone. And therefore, this passage is an injunction upon meditation upon the Atma. In short, this is just a this Karma Kanda. As we said yesterday, that they believe that action alone can produce something that you do not have. That happiness or moksha is something to be acquired, and therefore you must perform an action. And the upasana or meditation also is a mental action. And therefore, this is an injunction pertaining to meditation upon the Atma. So Vashyakara said, Nacha Atmetyopasita iti apurvavidhi. The statement Atma ityopasita, may one meditate upon the Atma, is not a vidhi, is not an injunction. Kasmat, why do we say that? Atma Swarupa Kathana Anatma Pratishedha Vakya Janita Vijnana Vyatirekena Arthantrasya Kartavyasya Manasasya Bahyasya Va Abhava. Kasmat, why do you say that? Says now Anandagiri, Hetu Bhagam Prashnapurukam Vivranote. What is Hetu? Arthantara Abhava. That's the reason. So Hetu Bhagam, the reason, Prashnapurukam Vivranote. So Bhashyakara explains why. Why do we say that Atma is, this is not an injunction pertaining to meditation upon Atma? Why? Kasmat. So says Anandagiri, Atma Upadeshena Anatma Nisheda Dvara Vakyotha Jnana Atarekena Diyavata. So Atma Upadeshena Anatma Nisheda Dvara Vakyotha Jnana Atarekena Na Kartavyantara Masti. So what do the words of the Upanishads do? Atma Upadeshena, by Upadesha or instruction or unfoldment pertaining to the Atma or the Self, Anatma Nisheda Dvara, as you say, really what the words of the Upanishads have to do primarily is Anatma Nisheda. Anatma Nisheda means a negation of Anatma or the non-self. What do you mean by a negation of non-self? That the body, which is a non-self, is taken to be the Atma. So the upadhi, the body, mind, intellect, which anatma, the non-self, is taken to be atma. And that generates in me this notion that I am a mortal being, that I am an ignorant being, that I am a limited being. So all these limitations, mortality, ignorance, all of these which belong to the upadhi, they are habitually superimposed upon the atma. And therefore, the notion that I am a jiva, is a notion. So this is called anatma. Anatma means what? Anatmani Atma Buddhi. Then I take the Anatma, the non-self, to be the Atma, and that alone is a problem. So what do the words of Upanishads, what do they do? Anatma Pratishedha Vakya Janita. So Atma Swarupa Kathana. First of all, the Upanishads tell us, what is the nature of Atma? Atma Swarupa Kathana. Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Vijnanam Anandam Brahma. That Brahma is Atma, that is Satya, Jnana, Ananta, Vijnanam, Anandam, Nitya, Shuddha, Buddha, Mukta. In this manner, Swarupa or the nature of Atma is first made known to us. Anatma Pratishedha Vakya. Neti Neti Asthulam Ananu Akhraswam Adirgham. That Atma Tattva is not gross, not subtle, not tall, not short, not long, not short, whatever. And thus various notions that are entertained about the Atma, all of them are negated. So, two things are done by the Upanishad. One is that negation of the various notions about the Atma, and second is enabling me to see the nature of the Atma, revealing the true nature of the Atma, that is Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Purnamadaha, Purnamidam, that it is complete, and even now also it is complete. So, Vijnana, and this generates what? Vijnanam. What it does is, dispels the various notions about the Atma. As I understand the meaning of these words, that I am not tall, I am not short, I am not red, I am not black, whatever, or I am not Sukhi, I am not Dukhi. Thus, meaning that all of these are the notions because of that these Sukha, Dukha, etc. are all the characteristics or attributes of Anatma and not of Atma. So thus we find Vidheya Vakyas and Nisheda Vakyas. Those Vakyas of Upanishads which reveal the nature of the Atma, and other Vakyas of Upanishads which dispel or which negate the Anatma, the notions of Anatma. Vijnana Vyatirekena Arthantarasya, meaning Kartavyasya. So Vashyakara said, Arthantara Abhavad. What is Arthantara? It says, Kartavyasya Manasasya Bahyasya Abhavad. So once the knowledge is gained, once I have understood what the Upanishads say, and if you have not understood what the Upanishads say, regardless of what you do, it's not going to change. So either I have understood what the scriptures say, or I have not understood. But just because I am frustrated because I have not understood, that doesn't mean that by doing something that I will understand. Understanding can only come by vichara, by dwelling upon them, by deliberating. And what we mean by shravanam is vichara. That vichara, vakya vichara. So Upanishad vakya vichara must be done. And so, that is the only way one would know. There is no other way. So I have to understand the meaning of the words. What is nitya, shuddha, buddha, mukta, vijnanam, anandam, satyam, jnanam, anandam? What is the meaning of these words as unfolded? Or what exactly is meant by saying asthulam, ananu, when there is a negation? I have to understand that. And whatever that understanding calls for, that is what I have to do. If that understanding requires a preparation of my mind, I should do that. But should not take out understanding as an option, you know. So we are accustomed to taking out option. This much I am not going to do. This much only I will study. So we want options. Swamiji, suppose can we, all this every day, you know, this is going on. Can that be option? Instead, can I live my life? No, living the life cannot be unless life, what is life is understood, you know. And therefore, how can you live life unless you know what life is all about? And how will you know unless you understand this? But how to translate all this into, this is very high level, Swamiji. So how to translate that into a mundane life? There is no mundane life. Everything is one level only. So therefore, we have to learn to translate. That's all. It's a learning process. And as I say, frustration very often comes and we get discouraged. But the point is, unless we understand, without understanding, just because you do something doesn't mean anything. I may drive hundreds and hundreds of miles, I may reach nowhere. I may have the satisfaction that I did a lot of driving, I did a lot of traveling, but where did I reach? Nowhere. I may do a lot of things in my life, alright, but merely doing is not life. Doing with understanding. Understanding alone is life. In fact, doing also, we say that karma also is a means of knowledge. So perform the karma or do things in such a manner that action becomes a means of knowledge. That every action reveals some secret of life, that's all. Every action is nothing but a situation which therefore reveals something about life. And thus, every situation should become a means of knowledge, not means of some other kind of satisfaction. So we want action to become a means of some other kind of a satisfaction. That I accomplished this, I read this, and so on and so forth. That's a distraction. And so, really speaking, every action, when we say karma yoga, is a means of knowledge. That means that karma should be only looked upon as an occasion to learn. Occasion to learn. And learning is growing, that's all. Learning is growing. So as we learn, we grow. But Swamiji, I know everything, but still it doesn't come into my life. That means that step of learning is to be done, that's all. That when it becomes spontaneous, what is called learning is when it becomes myself. And so whatever steps are required to transform that learning, so-called intellectual learning, into the day-to-day life learning, even that also is a process, which calls for alertness, and which calls for a lot of things. It calls for alertness, and it calls for a need to sacrifice, you know, whatever comes in the way by way of obstacles. But anyway, so jnana vyatirekena kartavyasya abhavat. So we say once the knowledge has taken place, meaning once the knowledge is assimilated, let's say, put it this way, when the knowledge is assimilated, lot of dramatization is there, like this knowledge takes place, nothing is to be done. There is no such process that like this it takes place and everything is done. It takes place as a lifetime process. It keeps on taking place. So don't have this kind of fantasies, you know, that something happened, it clicked, and that's it now, nothing remains to be done. So it keeps on clicking and clicking and clicking, that's all. You keep on learning, learning, growing, growing, growing. The fruit doesn't grow, doesn't become ripe like that. Nothing happens like this in the world. Even though Upanishad gives illustrations of lightning and things like that, meaning when it is understood like this, okay. But that itself is a culmination of a lot of process, you know, of vichara that has taken place. We might feel that many inventions have taken place, or discoveries have taken place, many scientific laws are discovered just in accident. He was doing one thing and he discovered something else. It cannot be. Because unless he had been thinking about that thing, there is no way that he can recognize what is happening. So many discoveries are said to be an accident. That Columbus by accident, that's all right. But to discover America or what it is, lot of effort was required. He may have wanted to discover India, that's all right. But it's not that America was discovered just like that. He had to travel and he had to undergo all that trouble that was required. And therefore, all knowledge always takes place as a result of the learning process. So we say that life is learning. That is called living. That is called growing. So don't bypass this life. Don't bypass the process of growing, you know, and then that's what everybody wants. Some bliss out, you know, something happens. And children, they don't want to go to school, they don't want to go to college, they don't do anything. But I'm a spiritual person and therefore keep on repeating. And then this hate goes in something else, you know. So very often when people are awkward or when people are abnormal, very often abnormality is only interpreted as spirituality, you know, very often. Something abnormal happens to me, therefore is a spiritual person. So many fantasies are there about spirituality, but whole life is spiritual life. There is nothing unspiritual at all, because spirit is involved in every action, in every experience, in everything. So everything should become spiritual. Every action or every occasion should become spiritual. And that way, when the knowledge is assimilated, kartavyantara bhavat, when it has become my own self, nothing remains to be done. There is no meditation then required, nothing is required. Manasasya bhashyasya va bhavat. And so no mental action, nor any physical action is required once the understanding has come. So one Atma is understood. And so Shravanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam, all of these are nothing but the process of understanding. I understand by Shravanam. By Mananam I make it my own. So that understanding expanded into all the whole process of thinking. All my patterns of thinking, all of them are addressed in light of my understanding, and therefore every pattern of thinking is addressed, and every pattern of thinking wherever required is transformed. That is mananam. And then if any habitual error still remains, then alertly owning up that knowledge is nididhyasanam. So this mananam nididhyasanam are nothing but extension of shravanam alone, extension of learning, that's all, extension of learning process. Not that having learned then you do something. So all Vashyakara is saying is, you just have to learn or understand Atma. And once having done, nothing, no further remaining remains to be done. Because when you understand Atma, you know that Atma alone is. That's how it is understood. Atma Vedam Saram, everything is Atma. Then where will you go? And what will you do? What remains to be done? When everything is Atma, and until it is understood that way, it is not understood. So if everything is Atma, what is inside also is Atma, what outside also is Atma, everything is Atma. If Atma is understood that way, what remains to be done? And therefore, kartavyasya manasasya bahyasya vabhavat. Now continuing with Bhashya on the page 223. Now anyway, many technical questions arise and says Anandagiri, kartavyantara bhavevi vakya janita vijnanam eva vidheyam syat. Alright. Somehow they want to bring in vidhi, you know. Kartavyantara bhavevi. Alright. That is true. That after the knowledge has taken place or after the understanding has dawned in me, that nothing remains to be done. Kartavyantara bhavevi. Nothing remains to be done. Once knowledge having taken place, vakya janita vijnana, vakya janya vijnana meva vidheyam syat. But how will knowledge take place? Knowledge having taken place, nothing remains to be done. But how will knowledge take place? He says, for the knowledge to take place, we say that there must be vidhi or there must be an injunction. Iti asankyaha. So for the knowledge to take place, isn't an injunction required? So now Vashyakara is explaining to us what is the meaning of this vidhi or what is the meaning of injunction? Or what can we call, what vakya can we call vidhi vakya and what vakya is not vidhi vakya? Which is the vakya that can be called vidhi vakya, meaning a statement of injunction, and what is the vakya that is not a statement of injunction? That difference has to be understood. Because vidhi vakya also only is jnapakam. Every vakya of the Veda, Veda is that which makes us know. And so, satyam vada, dharmam chara, all of these are sentences which make us know something. The satyam vada, meaning that I should speak truth. Dharmam chara, I should follow my kartavya dharma. That's knowledge. So vidhi vakya also give knowledge. Upanishad vakya also give knowledge. And still, why the vakyas of karmakanda, yajeta, swarga kamo, yajeta, that one desire of swarga should perform this yaga, that also gives the knowledge that this Agni Stoma is, Jyoti Stoma is a means of swarga. So vidhi vakya also gives knowledge and Upanishad vakya tattvamasi also gives knowledge. What is the difference in the knowledge? So when the knowledge takes place, then what happens determines whether that vakya is vidhi vakya or not. And that's what Bhashyakara explains. Tatrahi says here. Tatrahi videhe safalyam yatra vidhi vakya shravana matra janita vijnana vyatirekena purusha pravrittihi gamyate yatha darsha purnamasabhya svarga kamo yajeta ityeva madau tatrahi vidhivadinam samprati sampratipatyartha hi shabdha. So this is accepted by everybody. Tatrahi, he shows prasiddhi, general acceptance. Tatrahi videhe safalyam. So that particular vakya is called vidhi vakya. Or that is where the vidhi vakya has a safalyam, really gains its success or gains its fulfillment. Yatra vidhi vakya shravana matra janita vijnana vyatirekena purusha pravrittihi gamyate. Vidhi vakya shravana. You listen to vidhi vakya. So swarga kamo yajeta. This is the vidhi vakya. One desirous of heaven should perform this yaga. Vidhi vakya shravana. You listen to this vidhi vakya. Janita vijnana. When you listen to the vidhi vakya, it generates vijnanam, it generates knowledge, as every vakya does. It's a statement. Every statement generates a knowledge or understanding. Dasya Purnamasabhyam Svarga Kamo Yajeta. One who is desirous of Svarga should perform a yaga called Darsha Purnamasa. Darsha is Amavasya, the new moon. Purnamasa is full moon. And therefore the yaga they should perform on the new moon day and the full moon day. So one should perform these yagas called Darsha and Purnamasa for if one is desirous of heaven. This is information, this I know. So number one, Vakya, this statement such as this, which we call this statement, they themselves generate a knowledge in me that now I realize, oh I see. That means if I want Svarga, I should perform this Darsha Purnamasa Yaga. Means this Vakya actually reveals Darsha Purnamasa as a means for Svarga. So far I did not know, I am desirous of Svarga. I do not know how to achieve Svarga. So now I come to know, this is called Apurva Vidhi. I come to know what I did not know so far. I did not know the means for Svarga. So this tells us that Darsha Purnamasa is by performance of this Yaga, one can attain Svarga. One with desire of Svarga should perform this. So this is Jnanam. Says Vashyakara, Tad Jnana Vyatirekena Purusha Pravrutti Gamyate. So this kind of a knowledge generates what? Pravrutti means anusthanam. That now Purusha is actually induced to perform an action beyond this knowledge. So when I gain the knowledge that Darsha Purnamasa is a means of Svarga, then what does that knowledge do to me? It induces me to perform that Darsha Purnamasa because I am desirous of Svarga. So anybody who is desirous of heaven, suppose there are many people who want to go to the United States. Suppose tomorrow somebody be told, tell them, if you want to go to the United States, go to this agent. 17,000 rupees, he'll get you visa for the United States. Now suppose I make an announcement like this, nobody will bother. Somebody could bother. Somebody say, hey, wait a minute, I want to go to the United States. Suppose there is a desire of going to the United States, immediately that person will proceed to perform an activity of following whatever procedure is required to go to the United States. And therefore, this kind of statement induce a person to perform an activity. So those kind of statements, the knowledge of which induces a person to perform an activity, those kind of statements will be called Vidhivakya. Yasa, so Purusha Pravrutti Gamyate. Pravrutti means anusthanam. Vidhivakya Shravana Matra Janita. Siddhartha Bodhi Vakya Vyavartanam. Meaning, naturally it is Vakya pertaining to something to be accomplished. So generally speaking, Vakya or a statement, the object of which, the content of which is something that is not yet accomplished like Svarga. So when you hear about something which is not yet accomplished, then that creates in you an inducement to perform an action to accomplish that. So these Vakyas we call Vidhivakya. Or a Vidhivakya finds its fulfillment only when it generates an inducement in the person to do something. Alright, says Anandagiri further, Drishtantepi Vakyotra Jnana Tirekena Purusha Pravrutti Asiddhayati Ashankyaha. Well, how does it create Pravrutti? So these are all fundamental questions, you know. As though this is the first Upanishad, as though this is Tattva Bodha, that's how this book is treated sometimes. It is Tattva Bodha and Brahma Sutra Bhash, both are there. So certain questions are so fundamental or so elementary rather, that we wonder, you know, whether that is what the question means or it means something else. But some questions are very elementary and some questions are very technical also. So says Anandagiri, Drishtantepi Vakyotra Jnana Tirekena Purusha Pravrutti Asiddha. Alright, you say that Darsha Purnamasa Abhyam Svarga Kamo Yajeta, that one should perform Darsha Purnamasa Yaga, Darsha Purna Yaga in order, if one is desirous of heaven, how does it create Pravrutti? He is asking. Even that also does not create Pravrutti, then Vashyakara says here, Nahi Darsha Purnamasa Vidivakya Janita Vijnanameva Darshapurnamasa Anushthanam. He says, well, Darshapurnamasa Vidivakya Janita Vijnanam. So when you hear that, hey, Darshapurnamasa, when you perform, that you can go to Swarga. That knowledge is not the performance of Darshapurna Yaga, or that is not also the attainment of Swarga. You don't just reach Swarga by knowing that this train, you don't reach Kashmir by knowing that this train takes you to Kashmir. You must travel in the train to reach Kashmir. In short, whenever we are talking about the ends in life that are not accomplished, then to accomplish the ends that are as yet unaccomplished, something must be done in order to accomplish them. So, if you make an application, then you can go to school of medicine, fine. You can become a doctor by going to medical school. That knowledge will induce me to go to medical school if I am desirous of becoming a doctor. But by knowing that, one can become the doctor by going to medical school, I don't become the doctor. I must go to medical school and I must study medicine, then I become doctor. So, whenever we are talking about all those ends that are not accomplished, like at the moment I just passed SSC, you know, or whatever it is, HSC, and I want to become a doctor, then I don't just become doctor by knowing that by going to medical school one becomes doctor, I should go to medical school and do whatever is required to become a doctor. So also, Nidarshapurnamasa Vidivakyajanra Vijnanam Eva Darshapurnamasa Anusthanam. So merely knowing that Darshapurna, these yagas are means of Swarga, doesn't mean that you perform those yagas. You have to do something in order to perform the yaga. So pravritti or anusthanam that performs the yaga is required for Swarga to be accomplished. Then says Anandagiri, tad anusthanam tarhi vakyartha jnana adhinamidhi vyartho vidhi. Then how do you call it vidhi vakya? It's like any other vakya. Tad anusthanam tarhi vakyartha jnana adhinam. That means that you perform the Darshapurnamasa Yaga as a result of knowledge that is generated from this Vakya. Then why do you call it Vidhi Vakya? So, Vidhyartha, it is not the Vidhi, it is not because somebody told you that you are doing. It is because you knew then that you are doing. So Vidhi is what? Injunction. Did you perform Darshapurnamasa Yaga because the Veda says? Or did you perform the Darshapurnamasa Yaga because you want to do? So, when I learned that Darshapurnamasa is a means of Swarga, it is that knowledge that induces me to perform and not that Vakya. What induces me to perform that action? It is the knowledge that induces me to perform the action and not that Vakya. So that means that you don't require Vidhi, this knowledge is what induces you, and therefore, it is not the Vakya that induces you, therefore, Vyartho Vidhi, then Vidhi doesn't have anything to do. It is not somebody's instruction that makes you do, it is a knowledge that makes you do, isn't it? You may instruct any instruction that you want to give, but still nothing happens, you know? And therefore, next Sunday, we are all, everybody is invited, let us say, to third age, you know, to do the plantation of the saplings. So that information goes, you know, that will go also to many, many years. Doesn't do anything. So it's nice to know. Swamiji, oh, I see. So, oh, you are going to do the plantation next Sunday. People show that curiosity. So you think that they will come there. Nothing doing. It's a general information. And so, that is not that this, even when we give instruction that everybody is invited to come next Sunday, that instruction doesn't make you come. The knowledge that the instruction generates may create in you a kartavya buddhi. Say, hey, this is our ashram, you know, and so we should do something. Suppose such a thing happens, and then somebody will go and do it, or whatever induces people to go. There may be different reasons. Oh, it's nice, let us see how it looks like, and let us see, I will have fun and things like that. So different, the idea is that it is the knowledge that induces a person to do something, and not the instruction. In that case, the vidhi or instruction does not have any role to play. Tachchaiti. So Mahashyakara says, Tachcha adhikaradi apekshanubhavi. So tachcha anusthanam. that anusthana, it is not that just because you hear the statement that you start performing darsaguna masa yaga. But svarga kamo yajeta, one who is desirous of svarga, he should perform darsaguna masa. If I am desirous of svarga, then alone this statement will induce me to perform an action. So by doing this, you can go to United States, provided I am interested. Otherwise, it's just genuine. So many pamphlets come about Timbuktu and everything, you know. They invite you everywhere. Who goes there? They are not interested. So therefore, there are many countries actually, where all the tourist bureaus and all kinds of bureaus, Russia, they keep on inviting you. We are not interested there. It's nice to know. Oh, Russia has such and such state, a city called Moscow and the Red Square and all general information. It does not induce anything in me. So only I am an adhikari, meaning when I have the samskara of somehow seeing the Red Square, oh, I don't know what, you know. So when I give description of Paris, then immediately somebody says, Swami, I want to go to Paris, you know. So you get such an excitement. And then, so if samskaras are there, then one may want to do that. Otherwise, many people hear about Paris, so it's good. That's where it ends. So, even this knowledge also will not induce activity in everyone. It will induce depending upon the various factors to be completed, namely adhikari and so forth. I may be adhikari also, meaning I may be desirous of going to Swarga also, but I don't even have a penny with me. This Darsapurna Masa may require a lot of resources and a lot of materials. If I don't have them, then also I can't perform them. And then I may be desirous also, I may have resources also, I don't have anybody to perform it. I don't know how to perform, and there is no competent person available to perform it, then also you cannot do it. So, artha is required, resource are required, samarthyam, capability is required, vidvatta, knowledge is required, and so desire is required, resources are required, knowledge is required, then alone any action can be performed. Even the simplest action can be performed only when all that samagri or all the various accessories that are required to fulfill the action, when all the accessories are there, then alone action can be performed. So it is not even that the knowledge induces. Knowledge will result into anusthanam or performance of action when all these various accessories are present. Tacha adhikaradi apekshanubhavi. What is adhikara? Says Anandagiri. Adhikara vidhi purusha sambandha. And what does that mean? So footnote number 7. Vidhi purusha sambandha niyojya niyojaka bhava rupaha. Satkritajnanam cha ayam vidhi mam pravartayati iti akaram bodhyam. So when you hear that, then you say, hey, this is what is inducing me to do. This is for me. This is what people say, you know. This is for me. So when you hear that, when you hear description about France and so forth and so on, or Muscat, let us say, you know. This is for me. You know the doctors in Muscat, you know how much salary they get, and this, and then immediately the doctors, this is for me. So I am vidhi mam pravartayati. Hey, this impels me, or this induces me to do something. So one feels induced. One feels impelled. One feels inspired or prompted to do something, then alone anusthanam. So what kind of a knowledge? That knowledge which will create a prompting into a person, that alone can result into performance or anusthanam, and not a knowledge which does not create prompting or inducement. So we say that darsapurnamasabhyam svargakamo yajeta. So one desires of heaven should perform darsapurnamasa. That will generate the activity in terms of performance of the yaga only in those persons who have the desires and other requirements are fulfilled, then alone they will be induced to perform an action. Tatrahi vidhe safalyam. Then the vidhi has gained its safalyam, has gained its fulfillment when it actually generates an activity over and above the knowledge. So after knowledge, activity should come. That is called vidhi. Tarhi prakritevi. So adhikaro vidhi, vidhi purusha sambandha. Tatkrita jnana apeksham anusthanam. Anusthanam takes place after the knowledge that comes from this knowledge of adhikara, etc. It is arthavan vidhi. Therefore, vidhi also has a role. So vidhi creates a knowledge only in a particular person. And therefore, vidhi definitely has a role to play. Tarhi prakritebi vakyotra jnana vyatarekena purusha vyapara sambhavat vidhi safalya vidhi ashankyaha. Tarhi purvakande niruktarihitya vidhi safalya sati. Just as in karma kanda, these vakyas induce a person to perform an activity, and that is how the vidhi has safalta. So vidhi vakya has fulfillment when it creates an inducement. That's called safalyam of the vidhi. Similarly also we say that the Vedanta vakyas also, tatvamasi, aham brahmasmi, neti neti, they also create an inducement in the person, and that is how they also can be called vidhi vakyas. Tarhi prakritebi, prakriti means Vedanta vakyeshu abhi, vidya avasthayam abhi vyavada, even after the knowledge, or even the Vedanta vakyas. Vakyotra jnana vatirekena, purusha vyapara sambhavat. You listen to the statement that I am complete, you say, oh, now I should do something. Is that what it does? Tattvamasi, you are that, you are limitless. What does it do? Hey, I must become limitless now? No. You are limitless. So when this is said, that's what Bhashyakara says. When you hear this, no, there is no inducement of any activity. Oh, now let me go and meditate. There is no inducement. If I am that, then what will meditation do? If I had to become limitless, then meditation can make me limitless. But this statement says, Tattvam Asi. Asi means you are. It just is a statement of an obtaining existing fact, not something that is to be accomplished. And that's the point that Bhashyakara makes here. So, natu iti, natu neti neti ityadi atma pratipadaka vakya janita vijnana vyatirekena darsha purna masa divata purusha vyapara sambhavate sarva vyaparo pashamahe duttva vakya janita vijnanasya natu. However, neti neti, so you are not this, that also is release, you know. To be told that you are not this also is releasing. You are not a samsari. Oh, that's great. What will it do to me? I am not a samsari. Wonderful. What do I have to do? Nothing. Because that's what I am pining for. I am craving to become free from samsara. Says, you are not a samsari. So, you are not sukhi. You are not dukhi. You are not karta. You are not bhokta. Neti neti. You are not a man, you are not a woman, you are not tall, you are not short, you are not son, you are not father. If I am son, I must do this. Father, I must do that. Husband, I must do this. Wife, I must do something. You are not wife. All doing is gone. You are not husband. All doing is gone. You are not a daughter. Thank God. You are not a son. So each one of these, neti, neti, neti. Every time I am saying not this, which means that it only dispels a notion. So all these notions I am entertaining about myself, that I am a father, therefore this is my duty. I am a son, therefore, in India anyway. Moment the word father comes, the duty comes right away. Son means duty. Every role is associated with duty. Any role you have, there is a duty. Wife, immediately remember that. So moment we say wife, immediately, wait a minute, I have to cook at home, and immediately all that train of thought starts. Father, immediately will remember this son. Oh, but now how about admission of my son and stuff like that, you know. And so, every designation of mine, in fact, creates in me a kartavya buddhi. So what Upanishad does is, all designations are negated. That you are not father, you are not son, na bandhur, na mitram. Guru naiva shishya. So, what is it? Name mrityu shanka, name jati bheda, Pitanaiva menaiva matana janma. I have no father, I have no mother, I have no bandhu, I have no mitra, no guru, no shishya. All the way. What does it do? Ityadi atma pratipadaka vakya janita vijnana vyatirekena. If these things happen, if these work, the thing is, if I am ready for understanding this, which I may not be ready, I may be too emotional to say that, no, don't tell me, Swami, that I am not father, I am father. Okay, then it's a different matter. So we are not always emotionally ready to be told this or ready to necessarily absorb what the sentences say for various reasons. I am so emotionally attached to certain roles. And I mean, you know, because I seek security from different roles and different reasons are there. And that being the case, I may not be ready to say, for we have partial listening. Certain things don't listen. Swami, you don't care. This is all right. That Vedanta keeps saying. So this much, you know, we bracket. And we listen only what we want to listen. Something that everybody wants to solve their problems. And all the problems of life, everybody, that's why we come here, Swami. So we are so much preoccupied with solving those problems. What to do about my daughter's marriage, and my son's admission, and my father's health, and my wife's this, and so on and so forth. That when that sentence comes, immediately I get tuned up. So, how about that? Other sentences, chalta hai. And therefore, so much identification with this limited life and the limited accomplishments, because I am seeking fulfillment through those limited accomplishments, that they are my life right now and therefore, I may not be ready to necessarily even hear this, or after hearing it, to assimilate it, to see the meaning. That freedom of mind I may not have, and that requires work. To get that free mind, which is happy to hear that I am not son, oh how nice. You are not father, oh that's wonderful. You are not a daughter, oh that's nice. So every sentence creates a release, you know. And that is what we call knowledge creates release, or mukti, freedom. And thus when that release is created, jnana vyatirekena na purusha vyapara sambhavati. What vyapara? What is to be done? Wait a minute, let me meditate, I am not daughter, let me meditate on that fact. What meditation? Because I am not. If I had to do something not to become that, it's a different thing. But Upanishad only makes statements of the existing facts, that you are not this and you are this. Two things they say. That you are free, you are pure, you are divine, whatever you want to hear, you are beautiful. The whole world may tell me anything. You are miserable, you are ugly, you are this and you are that. Upanishad says, you are beautiful. But I'm not ready to listen to that. No, I can't be. It cannot be. Because the whole world tells me that I am not. How can you say that I am? So it may take a long time to become emotionally prepared to assimilate the impact, you know, to get of this, what the Upanishad says. That is what we call yoga, karma yoga and everything else. But when the mind is ready to it, that's the mind that Shankaracharya is talking about right now. That when the mind is ready, it doesn't want to hang on to something. How we want to hang on to things? Because we see security in that. And so I see security in my father, my mother, my brother, my husband, my wife, my son. So when my security and when my well-being is all dependent upon all these things, I am not even ready to hear that I have nothing to do with them. I have things to do with them. And so, what we call these emotional problems are there, and that's the reason why the statements do not have the impact that they should have. Otherwise, you don't require more than a few classes, really speaking. But the fact that you have to do it for years and years, both the speaker and the listeners, that shows that a lot of things have to work out, you know. And that also is all right. I mean, there's nothing wrong in that. The things have to work out. The point is that neti neti. So Shankaracharya does not know all these things. That is the reason why he may not know our difficulties sometimes. So that's the reason why to him it may all look very simple. Neti neti ityadi atma pratipadaka vakya janita vijnana vyatirekena na purusha vyapara sambhavati. He doesn't know what he has to do now. You are not swarga kama. If you are Svarga Kama, if you are a desirer of heavens, then it's fine. You are heavens. That's what it says. The very question of going to heavens. Heaven is new, let us say. Then there is no question of... Therefore, a different dimension of I is revealed by the scriptures. A dimension different from what I think I am. And when that is revealed, it's not that I cannot understand. Don't worry about how the vritti take will, who knows? Don't ask this stupid question. Who knows it and who does not know it? We get so confused with these vrittis and stuff like that. You know it. Who else is going to know? Why worry about them? We are so concerned about mechanism, Swamiji. But this vritti comes and vritti, we are all struggling inside of the vrittis, you know. So this meditation becomes a fight. But ahankara is doing this. How to remove ahankara and stuff like that? And so, when you hear that you are that, what vritti is? Where is the problem, you know? So, that you are not a wife, you are not a woman, you are not a human being, you are not sukhi, you are not dukhi. You understand, don't you understand that? So, buddhi is capable of understanding this, that's all it is. If I don't understand because I have to prepare my buddhi, as I said, only problem is not that I have to become a PhD or study millions of scriptures, that is preparation. Just emotional preparation is required, that's all. I must be ready to drop things off, that's all. We are not ready to drop them off. A dropping off is very, very difficult. Dropping off of all kinds of attachments. I mean, source of security and stuff like that. We cannot drop off things. So they say, you know, this Gautam Buddha dropped off things. He walks, you know, he gets up from his Bodhi tree. Or so this dropping off, it may take a long time to drop off things. To recognize that this is worth dropping and that has nothing to do with it. It may take time. That is why understanding also is a process. So Swami always says that clarity always grows. And a beautiful example he always gives is that of a Polaroid film, Polaroid picture. If you take a Polaroid picture and pull out the picture, in the beginning you don't see anything. Just see a plain colored paper. And slowly and slowly, the outlines start manifesting. So then you see the outline. So Swami is sitting on the chair, and that's a picture. Swami is sitting on the chair, you take a picture, Polaroid. Swami is sitting on the chair, you see the outline. Then the outlines become more clear. Then what is your knowledge? Swami is sitting on the chair. Knowledge does not change. Swami is sitting on the chair. Outlines become clear, that's all. Not that, hey, I thought you were sitting, now I find that he's standing. No. Same knowledge, Swami is sitting on the chair, Swami is sitting on the chair, same knowledge remains, except that the details become clearer and clearer and clearer. It may take 2 minutes for the whole picture to become clear. Not that your knowledge has changed, that your knowledge become clearer and clearer and clearer. So getting clarity can be called a process. That's all we mean by growing, because growing is nothing but again vairagya, dropping off things. Emotional immaturity is hanging on to things. And that hanging on is understandable because of notions created from ignorance. And as understanding comes, that hanging on is not necessary. That's called dropping off. And thus, more I'm willing to drop off. They induce you to drop off things, that's all it does. Neti neti is what? Drop off. So once it is dropped off, nothing remains to be done because all my activities drop off things only anyway. Darsha Purnamasadivat Purusha Vyaparaha Nasambhavati. That just as by listening to Darsha Purnamasa, that statement, how I am induced to perform an action, yes, let me do that. In that manner, when I hear that, when I hear these statements, Nedi Nedi, not this, Samsari I am not, Sukhi I am not, Dukhi I am not, Desirer I am not, then no activities, no inducement is generated from that. On the other hand, sarva vyaparo vashama hetutvat tad vakya janita vijnanasya. On the other hand, the vijnanam, the knowledge that is generated by these vakyas, sarva vyaparo vashama hetutvat, it brings the cessation of all the vyapara. So as I hear, cessation, thank God. Okay, I am not even this, because if I am something, some activity, some kartavya is associated. Some duty is associated with every role, as I understand. This I am not, this I am not, this I am not. It just releases only from the need to do. Thus it brings about a cessation of the activity. Sarva vyapara upashama hetutvas. This knowledge becomes in fact a hetu or the cause for cessation of all the activities and not generation of activities. And still, another question is raised here. Atha vimatam pravartakam vaidika jnanatvat vidivakyottha jnanavadita ashankya. Vimatam pravartakam vimatam vedantavakyottham jnanam. We say that no, even this knowledge that you are not this and you are not that, or the knowledge that you are Nitya, Shuddha, Buddha, Mukta, even this knowledge also, pravartakam, that also is a knowledge that induces some activity, purupaksha. Why? Vaidika jnanatva. Because this neti neti are also the statements of the Vedas, just as yajeta, that is also a statement of the Veda. So vaidika jnanatva, we say that all vaidika jnanam is alike. So if the vaidika jnanam, the purvakanda, karmakanda induces me into activity, we say that even the jnanam generated from Upanishad Vakya also should induce activity, because Upanishad also is Veda and Karmakanda also is Veda. So this hetu is Vaidika Vakyatvad, Vaidika Jnanatvad. Drishtanta Vidhi Vakyotta Jnanavad. Like the knowledge generated from Vidhi Vakya, so also the knowledge generated from Upanishad Vakya should also be create inducement. Iti Ashankya. Pravartaka Vishayatvam Upadhi. He says, no, all Vakyas are Vedic Vakyas are alright, but there is a qualification. Upadhi means a qualification. That the Karmakanda Vakyas are qualified. Pravartaka Vishayatva, Pravartaka is Sadhyam. Taddi Swasiddhyardam Purusha Pravartto Prayojakam Bhavati. We say that the difference between the Vakyas of Karmakanda and Vakyas of Jnanakanda is that Vakyas of Karmakanda pertain to something that is to be accomplished, sadhya. And Vakya of Jnanakanda pertain to that which is already siddha, already accomplished. So there is a difference here. That Upanishad reveals something that is already accomplished, already obtaining. And like Atma, which is already there. On the other hand, Karmakanda talks about Swarga and talks about ends that are not yet accomplished. So Pravartaka Vishayatvam Upadhi. Or sadhya vishayatvam upadhi, that the vishaya of the vakya is different. In the case of the karmakanda, the vishaya of the vakya is sadhya vishaya, meaning something to be accomplished. In case of jnanakanda, vishaya is atma that is already accomplished, and therefore vishaya veda is there. Therefore, even though they are veda vakya, still the effects are different because the vishaya that they address are different. That is what it said here. Nahi, says the Vashya. उदासीन विज्ञानं प्रवृत्तिजनकं अब्रह्म अनात्म विज्ञान निवर्तकत्वाच्च एकमेवाद्वितीयं तत्त्वमसि इत्येवमादिवाक्यानां Nahi udasina vijnanam. This vijnana what? Udasina vijnanam. Nadu pravartaka vijnanam. So, there are two kinds of sentences can create two kinds of effects upon us. One is pravartaka vijnanam. One is a statement that induces an activity into me because it only invokes an incomplete self. So either you can tell me something that invokes in me an incomplete self, therefore it induces an activity to become complete. Svarga kama. If you want svarga, then do this. Then a desire is always invoked in me, and therefore there is a need to do something. This another vakya that invokes in me my complete being. Therefore, the karmakanda vakyas and vedanta vakyas induce or invoke a different person. One invokes an incomplete being, which is a product of ignorance. Therefore, one is in the realm of ignorance and perpetuates ignorance. Other one, on the other hand, dispels the ignorance. So Vedanta Vakya, Upanishad Vakya invoke in me the complete being that I am. tatvamsi, that thou art, that Brahma you are. Therefore, that complete, the whole being is invoked. That means it is dispelling the ignorance. On the other hand, the karmakanda is invoking me, an incomplete being, inadequate being, and therefore it invokes a desirer who wants to do something to become complete. So this is udasina vijnanam. This is udasina vijnanam. Udasina vijnanam is not inducing. Udasina means is non-inducing knowledge. Na pravritti janakam. Or udasina vishaya vijnanam. Atma is udasina, atma is akarta, abhokta. So knowledge of the atma is akarta, abhokta. That knowledge also is na pravritti janakam. So therefore, in one case, I am made to know what atma is, the karta bhokta. Therefore, that knowledge, which is knowledge pertaining to karta bhokta atma, is pravritti janakam. Knowledge pertaining to akarta abhokta atma is not pravritti janakam. Abrahma anat vijnana nivartakatvacha. Footnote number 6, or is it 9? No, 6 rather. Abrahmani brahma jnanam. Abrahmani vartakatvacha. Abrahman is what? Abrahmani brahma jnanam. So what is not Brahman? Taking it to be Brahma. Anatmani atma jnanam. What is anatma? Taking it to be atma. So as long as that is there, I take the anatma to be atma. Or what is mithya, I take to be satya. So long, of course, there is a pravardhanam. So long inducement is there. So long there is a sense of insufficiency. On the other hand, udasina vijnanam. Abrahma anatma vijnana nivartakatvacha. What the instruction of the Upanishads do is just release me, that's all. As you say, drop off. Again, dropping is not an action that you got up, therefore you have dropped off. It's not that. So we believe that we walk out, that is dropping of everything. Don't think dropping is an action, that's another problem. Dropping is what? Dropping of the notion. He walked out. That means he may be walking into something else. So it is not that an action is nivartakam. We are not going to drop. Dropping off is not an action. Although you may stand up and get up and so forth, that's okay. Because you are sitting because of something else, some compulsion. Now the compulsion is not there, that way you don't sit, that way you get up. So that's a different thing. Very often we are doing something out of compulsion. When that compulsion is not there, you drop that doing. And so it may look as though that vairagya also is an action. So you are compelled to do things. And now that you understand, you don't do them. And therefore you may perhaps be, you may wish to be where you would have wished always to be. And that you were forced to be somewhere else. And therefore you may walk away. But walking away is not vairagya. Dropping off of the notion is vairagya. So nivartanam. So what is it that you have to become free from? Abrahma anatma vijnanam. Mithyatve. Mithyayam satya buddhi. So that is mithya, satya buddhi, taking it to be satya. Anatmani atma buddhi, that is anatma, taking it to be atma. So this is what, these are the notions. And nivartakam, this jnanam, the Upanishad jnanam, those statements actually, they dispel these notions. How ekameva dvitiyam. What is Brahma? Ekameva dvitiyam. Abrahma nivartakam. Abrahma vijnana nivartakam. Brahma is what? Ekam eva dvitiyam. I thought Brahma is different from me. See, what I generally think is Brahma or God is away from me. What does Upanishad say? Ekameva dvitiyam. Brahma is one without a second. There is no second. That means I am not second. See, Brahma is second, meaning it involves, it admits of duality, then it can be different from me. So general notion about Brahma or God is that God is different from me. Upanishad says, ekameva dvitiyam. Brahma is one without a second, meaning Brahma alone is, there is nothing other than Brahman. That means Brahman is not apart from me. So parokshatva of Brahma, that Brahman is remote from me, that remoteness. And therefore I am not Brahma. That is dispelled by the statement ekameva dvitiyam. Brahman alone is, whatever it is Brahma. Really? Then I also should be Brahman, definitely. Everything is Brahman, right? Everything is I, that's true. If this is understood, then it is what? Abrahma Vijnana Nivartakam. So this statement, in fact, releases me from the notion of Abrahma, that I am not Brahma. Parnatma Tattvamasi, that thou art. Aitadapradam Sarvam Tat Satyam Sa Atma Tattvamasi Shvedaketo. He Shvedaketo, the self of the whole universe. So that Brahman is the self of the whole universe. And that alone is the reality. That alone is the self. And that you are. Then I took myself to be an Atma, or I took myself to be small Atma. That's the idea of the smallness is dispelled by this teaching. Ittamivari Vakyanam Jnanadvara Vakyanam Jnananam Diyavata. So this Jnana is what? Nivartakatvacha. So knowledge generated from this statements of the Upanishad, Nivartakam, in fact, all the pravritti, there is a cessation of all the activities. It is ignorance that brought about the ignorance, notions born of ignorance brought about all the activity, and this knowledge, in fact, releases me from a need of any activity. So it is said, mithya jnana anivartakatvam upadhyantaram iti. First is what? There are certain differences between the vidhivakya of karmakanda and the vakya of the Upanishad. First is the vakya of the karmakanda pertain to the object, pertain to the matter which is away from me, unaccomplished sadhya vishaya, whereas Vedanta deals with siddha vishaya, already accomplished. Second, the vakya of karmakanda perpetuates ignorance. I already think that I am a karta, bhokta, sukhi, dukhi. I already think that I am in need of swarga. Then they say, hey, you want swarga? Yes, then do this. That means what? That desirer is perpetuated. So, mithya jnana anivartakatvam, meaning those sentences of karmakanda do not release me from mithya jnanam. They perpetuate the mithya jnanam or notions about myself. Whereas, the Upanishad vakyas, they in fact release me from mithya jnanam. So that they dispel all the notions about the self. So two things are there. The karmakanda vakyas perpetuate the notions, and the Vedanta vakyas dispel the notions. That's another upadhi, meaning another difference is there between the two. So that's another qualification that the karmakanda vakyas have. And that's what Bhashyakara said, abrahma anatma vijnana nivartakatvacha. So how these Upanishad vakyas also is bring about a cessation of notions. And third, page 224, Anandagiri says, Vakyotya jnanasya tan nivartakatvebi parvartakatvam kim nasyat tan nivartakatvebi. Again, footnote number 6, Atma sakshatkarasya sampannatva vidhim vina eva. So tan nivartakatve should be merely the viparita jnana nivartakatve. That's how it should be, you know. So mithya jnana nivartakatve. Vakyotva jnanasya tan nivartakatve, meaning mithyatva jnana nivartakatve. In short, the Upanishad vakyas, they dispel the notions, okay. Pravartakatvam kim nasyat, all right. Suppose I understand that I am not sukhi, I am not dukhi, I am not karta, I am not bhokta, I am not this, I am not this. And still this knowledge, why should it not induce me into activity? How is this knowledge opposed to inducement of activity? That's the question. So Bhashyakara, nacha tannivrittau pravrittihi upapadyate virodha. Nachatan nivrittau, mithya jnana nivrittau. In fact, when the notions are dispelled, nacha pravritti upadyate, there cannot be any pravritti. It's not tenable that releasing from the notion, because pravritti or any kind of an activity to accomplish something was a result of a notion. What is the notion? I'm incomplete, I'm inadequate. So every idea, every notion about myself creates in me a sense of inadequacy. So when I take myself to be a father or a mother or whatever I take, even a king if I take myself to be, even that also creates, even Hiranyagarbha, I say, that also creates in me a sense of inadequacy of some kind. Because every word is going to have a concept, and that is going to be limited. When I am a king, I am not something else. So even when I am living in my palace, and I observe all the passers-by and stuff like that, sometimes I may be envious of them. Says, look how free they are. They can go wherever they want to go. They can sit where they want to sit. I can't do as a king. Prince Charles cannot do a lot of things that you and I can do. Even a Swami cannot do many things that non-Swami can do, really. Just because you wear this peculiar dress, and therefore, you can't do so. Well, Swami, I cannot do certain things, naturally. And so, thank God that I don't feel any need to do anything else. But then, as I say, Prince Charles can feel, you know. See, he just can't walk. Can he walk in the streets of London? He cannot. He must have all sorts of pilot cars behind, all sorts of protection and stuff like that, and the security must be there. He has no privacy. Isn't it funny? He doesn't have privacy at all. At least on his doors, the security agents are there, you know. So if nothing else, there's always an inference of what is going on inside. And it's just stupid. The thing is, what I'm saying is, that however great I may be, still that also places certain restrictions on me. So any idea about myself, any sense of identification about myself, always brings also a sense of inadequacy anyway. President Clinton, he's the greatest man, you know, in this world at this moment, and still he doesn't have freedom. Because everything is watched. What does his wife do, and what does he do, and what do they do, and what does she talk, what does she not talk, how does she dress, everything. In fact, you just become such a public property that they would feel they just get suffocated with the thing. And so every accomplishment always calls for its price. Anyway, this is all understood. What I am saying is that any time I have any kind of an idea about myself, a notion about myself is derived from anatma, non-self, identification with non-self. So when I identify with my wealth, then I am wealthy. I identify with my power, then I am powerful. I identify with my body, then I am father, mother, so forth. Each one of these ideas about me brings about a sense of inadequacy. Immediately brings about an idea of what I don't have, unfortunately. That I am learned also, I have learned so and so, then also, it just brings me an idea of what I have not learned. Swamiji, I did this, but still I have not done that. Still, that remains to be done. So even the fact that I am learned, if I have that kind of notion about myself, then also it brings about a sense of inadequacy right away. And therefore, so when that mithya jnanam is nivruttam, meaning when mithya jnanam is removed, the sense of inadequacy goes away. Mithya jnanam is the notion, or the self-judgment or self-notion. So when these notions are dispelled, the inadequacy created from the notions also get dispelled. Na pravritti upadyate. Then where is the question of pravritti? When I feel adequate, there cannot be any pravritti at all. You need not feel adequate. Stop feeling inadequate. Swami, inadequate I don't feel. But how do I feel adequate? Don't worry about it. Because the adequacy is merely denied because of the sense of inadequacy. When inadequacy goes, you need not do anything to become adequate. Don't do again something. Atma samstam manakrutva na kinchida vichintaye. And so again, when I am not inadequate, that means I am adequate. Otherwise, how can you not be inadequate? Na pravritti upadyate. And therefore, no pravritti or activity is tenable at all. Virodhat. Virodhat means this sense, the knowledge of adequacy and the pravritti are opposed to each other. That's all. Pravritti mithya jnana nivritti ho mitho virodhat. A pravritti mithya jnana nivartaka vakyotta jnana yoho va virodhat. Whatever. Sahana sthanat. The idea is that the knowledge of adequacy that is generated by the statements is opposed to any pravritti. Any compulsion, let us say. By pravritti we do not mean that person just sits tight. Even that also may be compulsion, that also may be an action. Of not doing something also is an action. There is no compulsion at all. So no compelled activity. That I have to do something, that is bondage. Doing something is not bondage. You may merely do whatever you want to do. You may not do what you not want to do. So doing something is not bondage and is not liberation also. Compulsion to do something is bondage, and freedom from that compulsion is the liberation. Thus this knowledge brings about a freedom from all compulsion. Therefore, when there is no compulsion, Where is the activity? And that's how it brings about a cessation of all the activities. Therefore we say that these vakyas cannot be classified as vidivakyas, which always induce an activity. Even though vidivakya also gives only knowledge, and knowledge does not induce any activity. Knowledge itself is not activity. But knowledge reminds me of my inadequate self, that's all. In short, karmakanda, they always remind us of how inadequate I am, what I don't have. And therefore induce in me a desire to have them. Whereas Upanishad tells me what all I have, and that releases me from the sense of inadequacy. That's all. Their activities are all opposed to each other. So you cannot compare the Upanishad Vakyas with the Vidhi Vakyas. Okay.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Bhadarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guratmedi Murti Veda Vibhagine Vyomavadhyapta Dehaya Dakshinamurtaye Namah Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om
Vedam Tarhya Vyakrita Masir Tannama Rupa Abhyam Eva Vyakriyate Asau Namai Vidam Rupa Iti Tadidam Apyetar Hi Nama Rupa Abhyam Eva Vyakriyate Asau Namai Vidam Rupa Iti Sa esha iha pravishtana khagrebhyah Yatha akshura akshura dhane vahitasya Vishvambharo va vishvambhara kulaye Tanna pashyandi Akrasno hisah Pranan eva prano nama bhavade Vadanva Pashyam chakshuhu Shranvan shrotram Manvano manah Tanyasya hitani karma nama anyeva Sayot ekaikam upaste nasaveda Akrasno hyeshah Ata ekaikena bhavade Atme tevopasita Atra hyete sarva ekam bhavande Tadedat padaniyamasya sarvasya yadayam atma Anena hyetam sa enena hyetat sarvam veda Yathahavai padenanu vinde devam Kirtim shlokam vindateya evam veda
Santara bhava atma atme tyopasita iti apurva vidhi. We say that atme tyopasita, that upasita is not a vidhi, is not an injunction that one should know atma. And when it is said one should know atma, naturally then knowledge becomes something that is to be done. When we say one should know atma, then knowledge becomes an action. Because that it involves should. That means it involves a will. It involves purusha prayatna or the will of a person. In that case, the meaning of the word knowledge itself will change. Knowledge, when it involves doing something, then it becomes one kind of knowledge. And knowledge does not involve doing something is a different kind of knowledge. So, what is the kind of knowledge where something is to be done? It is called meditation. And so, if upasita, one should know if this is a vidhi or an injunction. That means an instruction is given that one should know Atma. That means knowledge becomes a process, meaning it becomes a mental act. It becomes upasana, meaning meditation. So here the Mimamsaka say that here is a vidhi or an injunction for meditation upon Atma, because Atma can be known only by meditation, and therefore this is a vidhi. It can be known only through an act, mental act. We said no, it is not so, because what this statement and other statements the Upanishads do is all they do is Atma Surupa Kathana and Atma Pratishedha. All the other statements do is Atma Surupa Kathana. The statements such as Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, that Brahma is Satyam Jnanam Anantam, all that they do is merely reveal the nature of Atma. Vijnanam Anandam Brahma, that Brahma is Vijnanam Anandam, they merely reveal the nature of Atma. Or Neti Neti Asthulam Ananu, that Brahman is not gross, Brahman is not subtle, Brahman is not long, Brahman is not short. In this manner, when there is a negation, there is what? Anatma Pratishedha. Merely negation of the identification with Anatma. That's all these statements do. And the knowledge that takes place as a result of understanding the true nature of the Atma and becoming free from identification and Atma, other than that knowledge, nothing remains to be done. Kartavyantara bhavat. No kartavya, nothing remains to be done. Manasasya vahyasya va. Nothing remains to be done mentally, nor anything remains to be done physically. Because this knowledge itself is the end of, knowledge itself is the means of what you are searching for. Tatrahi vidhe safalyam. That knowledge alone is called vidhi. Where? Vidhi vakya sharana matra jana vijnana vyatirekena purusha pravrtihi gamyate. That is called a vidhi. That statement will be called vidhi. When the knowledge generated by the statement creates a need of an activity. Yatha darsha purnamasa bhyam yajeta swarga kamo yajeta. Just as a statement that the one desirous of heavens should perform the darsha purnamasa yaga. So when one hears this particular statement, then that very knowledge generates a need for an action. Swarga kamaha. Since the person is desirous of heavens, and when the person hears